الحسين خطت عنوان الفداء الشعار يبقى دوما عدا وإبا ثورة الحسين خطت عنوان الفداء الشعار يبقى دوما عدا وإبا كل يوم عاشورا كل أرض كربلا كل يوم عاشورا كل أرض كربلا.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين والخاتم النبيين أبي القاسم محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله أما بعد فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في القرآن الكريم وقوله الحق وهو أصدق الصادقين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وَجَاهِدُوا فِي اللَّهِ حَقَّ جِهَادِهِ وَاجْتَبَاكُمْ وَمَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجٍ مِلَّةَ أَبِيكُمْ إِبْرَاهِيمَ هُوَ سَمَّاكُمُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ مِنْ قَبْلُ وَفِي هَذَا لِيَكُونَ الرَّسُولُ شَهِيدًا عَلَيْكُمْ وَتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ صَدَقَ اللَّهُ الْعَلِيُّ الْعَظِيمُ. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for having granted you and I this existence, and I begin in His blessed name by thanking Him for this beautiful existence that He has given you and I, an existence in which there are very different forms of creation, people and existences of all different types, all different shapes, and all different forms. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala establishes in the Quran a fundamental principle that whatever He creates, الَّذِي خَلَقَ فَسَوَّى وَالَّذِي قَدَّرَ فَهَدَى, that whatever He creates, He fashions it, He creates it according to a specific measure, وَالَّذِي قَدَّرَ فَهَدَى, and then He guides it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran has clearly established a fundamental principle for you and I, that any creation, any existence has been guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is not a single existence that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has brought into existence, if we may say, that is bereft of guidance. Even something such as the bee. If you look at the bee, for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَأَوْحَى رَبُّكَ إِلَى النَّحْلِ, that your Lord, He reveals even to the bee. So even the bee has been given guidance by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and hence the bee knows exactly how to, you know, produce the honey and so on and so forth. So you find every existence that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has brought forth has been given the necessary guidance it deserves and the necessary guidance it needs to fulfill its purpose in this world. And as you and I know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran about you and I as human beings, that our purpose, one of the purposes, one of the core functions of our existence, Allah says, الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا, that surely He created death and life to test you to see which one of you is best in deeds. And on this examination of life that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed us upon, surely as an all-wise Lord, an all-just Lord, an all-merciful Lord, to place you and I upon an examination without giving you and I the necessary tools and resources to succeed upon this examination would appear as quite unjust. And hence Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you and I as human beings the necessary tools and resources to succeed upon this examination of life. And one of these core resources that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided you and I with is that of divine leadership, of what we call the system of wilaya. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, in the ayah of wilaya in Surah Al-Ma'idah, verse number 55, إِنَّمَا وَلِيُّكُمُ اللَّهُ ورسوله والذين آمنوا الذين يقيمون الصلاة ويؤتون الزكاة وهم راكعون, that surely your wali, your guardian is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, number one. But then that wilaya extends and has been given that extension by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the Holy Prophet, to His Messenger. إِنَّمَا وَلِيُّكُمُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. And then that system of wilaya, that guardianship, that divine leadership has been extended to a third group. Who is that third group? وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ وَهُمْ رَاكِعُونَ. An individual who fulfills three criteria. He believes in God. وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ وَهُمْ رَاكِعُونَ. He establishes prayer and he gives charity while in ruku. And as we know, in the annals of history, there is no individual that fulfilled these criteria other than Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. And if we examine this system of wilaya, the system of leadership, we'll find there is a very straightforward and profound hierarchy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you and I as human beings to follow. And that hierarchy begins with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself as the top, as the Lord of the world. And then it goes down to his messengers, the final and the most perfect and sublime of them being our Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then that wilaya, that leadership extends further to those who the Prophet appointed. And that is none other than, of course, the 12 holy imams that we have, the Ahlul Bayt of the Prophet. And that's what Allah said in the Quran, يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولَ وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ. That all you who believe, obey God, obey His messenger, and obey those who have been vested with authority amongst you. Who is this أُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ? Well, let's continue in the remainder of the verse. Allah says, فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ. If you have any doubts, if you need any clarifications, then go back towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His messenger. إِن كُنْتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. If you truly believe in God and His messenger, or rather, if you truly believe in God and the Day of Judgment, then Allah says, go back to God and His messenger for any doubts you may have. So if we have any doubts as who is the أُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ, let's go back to Allah and His messenger. And we know in the annals of history, there is no doubt regarding who the Holy Prophet appointed during his life as the leader after him. And we know that that was exemplified at the highest level at the event of Ghadir during the appointment, the open and grandest of appointments. For we know Imam alayhi salam was constantly declared as the messenger and the successor of the Holy Prophet after the Holy Prophet. But at the grandest level, this took place at the event of Ghadir, we know. So you'll find this interesting hierarchy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed for you and I is for you and I to learn how you and I need to operate in this examination of life. How you and I need to promote the good and how you and I need to forbid the evil. For you and I to learn what is the good and what is the evil. And it's very interesting that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have given you and I just a scripture in the written form, which we have, of course, in the Holy Quran, but He could have just given us the scripture without any leaders, without any role models, without any teachers to teach us and explain to us that scripture. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not choose such a methodology. Rather, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us divinely chosen individuals to teach us those scriptures and to teach us how to apply those scriptures in practice so we have no excuse against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment. That's what Allah says, رُسُلًا مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنذِرِينَ لِأَلَّا يَكُونَ لِلنَّاسِ عَلَى اللَّهِ حُجَّةٌ بَعْدَ الرُّسُلِ. That we sent you these messengers as givers of good news, as warners, so that you have no excuse, no hujjah, no proof against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment. For having given you and I these living leaders, these role models for us to look up to learn from, of how to put the theory into the practice in a living form as human beings, after having been granted that guidance, there's no excuse for you and I on the Day of Judgment against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the interesting thing about this paradigm of leadership is that each level in this funnel of leadership, each group reports to that above it. So if you look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the top of this paradigm, at the top of this pyramid, if we were to say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Lord of the worlds. Under Him comes the messengers and of course the Holy Prophet himself. And after the Holy Prophet, we have the Imams. But you find the Holy Prophet takes us back towards Allah. The Imams, the Ahlul Bayt, they take us back towards the Holy Prophet and Allah. So the importance of this system of leadership is that each group is taking us back to those preceding it. So the Holy Prophet takes us towards Allah. The Ahlul Bayt take us towards Prophet and Allah. And when it comes towards submission and our responsibility is to submit to all individuals or all existences in this paradigm of leadership. So my responsibility as an individual is to submit myself to the Ahlul Bayt, to submit myself to the Holy Prophet and to submit myself towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the most crucial part that is quintessential to understand is that when I am submitting myself to the Ahlul Bayt, I am submitting myself to the Prophet. When I'm submitting myself to the Prophet, I'm submitting myself towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's no distinction. It's the same system of leadership. It's the same concept of wilaya. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran. فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ وَيُسَلِّمُ تَسْلِيمًا. That by your Lord, they are not true believers until they make you, O Prophet, the judge between all of their matters. And then, no matter what you decide, they do not find within their heart any resentment toward the decisions you have made, and they submit to you, وَيُسَلِّمُ تَسْلِيمًا. Wholeheartedly, they submit to you. So when you find in the annals of history, there are certain companions during the life of the Prophet who contended with him on certain issues, who refused to obey him in certain issues, at certain events. And these disputes against the Prophet are portrayed as these individuals caring about Islam, as caring about the community. Such individuals have failed to understand the concept of leadership to begin with. Because when you submit to the Prophet, you're submitting to Allah. If you disobey the Prophet, you will go against the Prophet, you are going against Allah. Such individuals have not understood the concept where Allah says in the Quran about the Prophet, وَمَا يَنْتِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيُّ يُوحَىٰ. That the Prophet speaks, does not speak out of his own will. He speaks based on what God has commanded him to speak. And as Allah says in the Quran, وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولَهُ أَمْرًا أَن يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. It is not proper for a believer that after God and His Messenger have decided upon a certain matter, that now they have their own choice in the matter. No. When God and His Messenger have made a decision, you stick with that decision. And وَمَن يَعْصِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ ظَلَّ ظَلَالًا مُبِينًا. Whoever disobeys God and His Messenger, for them is a manifest, they are surely in manifest error. So when we look at the system of divine leadership, it is extremely crucial to understand, because you and I as human beings, we know we are all in search of role models, individuals to look up to. Look at society today. You'll find celebrities, actors, athletes. They're all extremely popular and people look up to them. They aspire to be like them. They want to dress like them. They want to eat like them. They want to talk like them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has clearly, within our fitrah, has placed this need for guidance, this need for role modelship. And hence Allah gives us these role models that we need to succeed in this examination of life in the holy prophets and the imams. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرُ وَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. That surely in the Holy Prophet you have the best of examples for the one who believes in God and seeks to return to God and remembers God much. So when we look at the event of Karbala, when we look at the event, even for example, the Battle of Siffin, what was the issue at the Battle of Siffin? You find when Imam Ali alayhi salam is fighting against the side of Muawiyah and the Imam is about to be victorious. But the side of Muawiyah decides to place the Quran upon their spears and is able to confuse the vast majority of Imam Ali alayhi salam's army. What was the problem? Why did these individuals get confused? Why was the Imam not able to defeat Muawiyah? It's because the people in his army had not understood the concept of divine leadership. They were easily confused by Muawiyah and the tricks of Amr ibn As placing their Qurans on the spears. And they said, no, how can we fight those who are placing Quran, who are holding on to the Quran? Such individuals have not understood that the Imam himself is the Quranun Natiq. He's the living Quran. What the Imam commands me to do is what the Prophet would have commanded me to do. And what the Prophet would have commanded me to do is, of course, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands me to do. And the event of Karbala, what's so profound about it is it shows the quintessential need to follow and submit oneself to divine leadership. On the side of Imam Hussein, in the companions of Imam Hussein, you'll find the perfect manifestation of individuals who submitted themselves to their leader. They submitted themselves wholeheartedly to the Imam, no matter the ramifications, no matter if it means losing my life losing my property doesn't matter. For the believers, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرْتَابُوا وَجَاهَدُوا بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الصَّادِقُونَ. The believers are those who believe in God, His Messenger, and then after that they don't doubt. And then they struggle. وَجَاهِدُوا بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. They struggle in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in the event of Karbala, we have the companions of Imam Hussein alayhi salam on one side, who have understood divine leadership. They've understood the Imam is the Quran in practice. They've understood that submitting to the Imam is like submitting to God and His Messenger. And on the other side, you have the likes on the side of Umar ibn Sa'd, those under the guidance of Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad, the likes of Yazid. They have failed to understand divine leadership. They, in fact, they say many individuals in the army of Yazid were memorizers of the Quran. So what happened? You see, if the book of God was sufficient, Hasbuna Kitabullah, then it would not, the event of Karbala would not have taken place. For these individuals knew the Quran, they were memorizers of the Quran. But the problem was they had failed to hold on to the right leaders and teachers to teach them how to properly understand and apply the principles of the Quran. That's what Allah says about the Holy Prophet. وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ. We reveal to you this reminder so that you may explain to the people what has been revealed to them. And the beauty of this event of Karbala is that it's a template for you and I on how you and I need to submit ourselves to divine leadership. That if the Imam of my time comes and tells me to do a certain thing, no matter the ramifications, I submit myself to him, for I recognize that this is the leader that God has sent for me, and whatever he wants from me, that is what is best for me. And I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you and I are able to understand this core and fundamental principle of divine leadership and take lessons from the companions of Imam Hussein alayhi salam in Karbala on how to submit ourselves to the divine leaders of our time, in order that we may submit ourselves truly the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala desires from you and I. وآخر الدعوان الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين.
إن ننسى الحسين فقد نسينا الإسلام. إن نسينا الحسين فقد نسينا عزتنا. إن نسينا الحسين عليه السلام فقد نسينا قيمة حريتنا. لا ننسى الحسين أبدا. أبدا 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 لن ينسى الحسين. لن ينسى الحسين.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على خير خلق ونور عرش أفضل الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيبنا وسيدنا وسندنا وشفيعنا ومولانا بالقاسم محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المأسومين المظلومين أما بعد فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتاب المجيد وقوله الحق وهو أصدق الصادقين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وإذ قال ربك للملائكة إني جاعل في الأرض خليفة صدق الله العلي العظيم. All praise belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I begin in His blessed name for granting us this life and giving us the opportunity to be moral and upright individuals, and that Allah has given us the opportunity through trials and tribulations and through the limited free will that He has given us to be able to elevate ourselves in this decision that Allah has made for the human race to reach the highest stations in this world and in the next world. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through this system, has blessed us with an intrinsic system of leadership, the kind of leadership that cannot be replaced. For there are many layers of leaderships, for we have leaders among ourselves, within the community, within the families, within nations, within continents. But we find that there is one culmination of leadership that we are here to discuss, because that is the kind of leadership that will bring harmony and it will bring success on this earth. And I'd like to emphasize that the first thing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did when He created this universe and when He created the human race in this universe, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ensured that the first human being was a prophet of God, that is Adam alayhi salam, and his wife was also the representative of women in the world. So what we find is that they become the seed to humanity, and the mother, who is Hawa, also sets the standard for humanity. So it's very important for us to understand that leadership and guidance affects the outcome of the future of societies. And what's profound is that when Adam was created, Allah commanded the angels to bow, as I discussed yesterday. And the importance of recognizing with honor, when Allah says, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي Adam, indeed, we have honored the children of Adam. This karama that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to the human race requires reflection and meditation. And it's important for us to understand that divine leadership, the paradigm of leadership, on its highest platform is divine leadership. For divine leadership is where all leaderships must follow. So in Surah Al-Baqarah, verse number 30, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. This is very, very profound. It's a foundation that we must pay attention to. Because when we go to Karbala, and when we listen to Imam Hussein alayhi salam fighting for justice and eradicating corruption on earth, it is not possible until the people recognize and realize divine authority. For the more people recognize divine authority, the greater the outcome for humanity. Unfortunately, there was a handful of people who paid attention to Imam Hussein alayhi salam's calling. But thank God that in the last 1400 years, that calling that Imam Hussein alayhi salam went with a small group of people is continuing to grow, such that more human beings now are adhering to that call that took place then. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the angels, with قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing the angels, that indeed, I am going to place, إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. Indeed, I'm going to place on the earth a representative. A khalifa is a leader, a one who represents Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, what is interesting is that the angels were made aware by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this creation called Adam and the children of Adam, known as Bani Adam, will create trouble. They will disobey. They will violate this core principle of divine leadership. And the argument of the angels, per the Quran, is that first of all, the angels don't disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's a very positive characteristic, being that they're angels made of light. So they are following a prescription of the divine without any questions, which makes them supremely successful in their own rights. They are made aware of this fact, that Adam's generation is going to reject Allah and they're going to cause mischief. قَالُوا. So the angel said, أَتَجْعَلُ فِيهَا مَنْ يُفْسِدُ فِيهَا وَيَسْفِقُ الدِّمَاءَ وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّيُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ. Very interesting logic that the angels are using. He says, you will praise a khalifa on earth. The very people of this khalifa will reject you and they will cause mischief and shed blood. Now listen to the interesting fact. So the angels are aware of the fact that humans who have been given limited free will violate the core principles of divine obedience and worship. And then they say, you see, وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ. So in other words, we celebrate your praise and we praise your holiness. In other words, we extol your holiness. What does Allah reply? And I want us to understand this within this paradigm, that you have a leader being chosen. The first human being is the leader. So Allah is telling me that the human race cannot function even for a split moment on earth without a divinely appointed leader. That's a foundation that we must understand. So any human being proposes the idea that the earth does not have an existent leader at any time in the existence of the earth and its human beings is actually teetering on conjectural talk, which is not true. The truth of the matter is that our existence is impossible without the leadership that God appoints. So when the angels are asking, they said, for example, we celebrate, we obey you, right? We elevate ourselves through your name. Allah replies, قَالَ إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Allah replies the angels, indeed I know that which you don't know. So let's understand, what is it that Allah knows that the angels don't know? For Allah knows everything. But what is it that the angels don't know that Allah now is going to expose that sets the foundation of divine leadership? What are the qualities of divine leadership? That what does this divine leader have for them to be considered divine? Because there's a lot to talk about. You'll notice prophets and imams, when they declare, even when they're born and they declare their prophethood in public, you will see that historically, from the time that they were born to the time of their death, they only speak the truth. They never recant anything. They don't take back what they have said. And they don't jump into conjectural talk only to find themselves wrong and acting foolish. That's not the quality of divine leaders. Divine leaders have confidence in what they say. They believe in what they say. And they have confidence in the outcome of it, even in the future. That's very important to understand. In the next verse, verse 31, Allah says, وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught Adam all the names. Names that are very important. We, of course, Allama Tabatabayin al-Mizan fi Tafsir al-Quran talks about the names, for there are many intrinsic secrets, hidden secrets too, that the average human being doesn't understand, the average creation doesn't understand, not even do the angels understand it. And Allah, when He exposes that and gives it to His agency, He now endows them with a certain level of power. For we know Allah's omnipotence and might is also principled on His power of knowledge. Allah says, "Yamunnuna alayka an aslamu." The desert dwellers, right? They now are thinking they're doing you a favor. Why when somebody accepts Islam, do they have this cockiness to think that they've done the Prophet and Allah a favor? But look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses this level of ignorance. Okay? Allah says, قُلْ أَتُعَلِّمُونَ اللَّهَ بِدِينِكُمْ. Say, are you teaching Allah your religion? وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses a very powerful sentence, and you'll see the Quran is repeating this principle all the time, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has all the knowledge. The wisdom belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ السَّاعَ وَيُنَزِّلُ الْغَيْثِ وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْأَرْحَامِ وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ مَاذَا تَكْسِبُ غَدًا وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُوتُ. Allah is showing His might by telling us He knows the time, He knows what lies in the wombs, He knows when the rain comes. No one knows what they will learn tomorrow. No one knows on which land they will die. These elements of knowledge gives us the understanding that the almightiness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is also dependent on His power of knowledge. So Allah is talking to the angels and saying, you don't have this knowledge. So your question is legitimate. You're asking a legitimate question, but you don't understand it. So the angels, in their wisdom, limited, realize that Allah now is going to expose to them the reason why He appointed Adam as the vicegerent of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the Khalifatullah. And the angels want to understand, what is it that Adam is being given that makes this Adam superior even to them? Hence, they were commanded to bow to Adam when Adam and Hawa received life. So Allah says, وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا ثُمَّ عَرَضَهُمْ عَلَى الْمَلَائِكَةِ فَقَالَ أَنْبِئُونِي بِأَسْمَاءِ هَؤُلَاءِ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. Very interesting. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says He taught Adam all the names, the names that are essential for Adam to know to represent God on earth as his leader. So that means that you and I cannot just willy-nilly choose a leader without the criteria of knowledge, without the criteria that the knowledge is absorbed, ilmul matbu, the one that has been absorbed, not the one that's masmu, the one that is heard. Some people hear a little knowledge, they go on Google, they read a little thing, and they consider themselves leaders. No. The kind where knowledge makes you so subservient that you become mukhlasin. Ibadaka minhumul mukhlasin. Even Iblis realizes that there are agencies of God chosen by Allah who are perpetually pure and sincere. So Allah is describing. He says, Allah taught Adam all the names. Then Allah presented them to the angels. And Allah said to the angels, tell me the names of those if you are right. Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now is challenging the angels that what I have taught Adam, tell me. قَالُوا سُبْحَانَكَ لَا عِلْمَ لَنَا إِلَّا مَا عَلَّمْتَنَا. So they reply, that glory be to you, Allah. We have no knowledge but that which you have taught us. Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءَ. In Ayatul Kursi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَشْفَعُ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ. Who can represent Allah without His appointment? What is Allah saying? يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ. He knows what is in front of them and what is behind them. Meaning Allah protects them, not only with the ability of insightfulness, the ability to see with basira, with taqwa, but Allah endows them with knowledge. Allah teaches them the secrets and gives them special knowledge. As we know, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had ruhul qudus. It's a special kind of holy spirit which enables them to see the reality without words, the reality without any impedance, the reality of what the universe is really about. Because when you and I are able to see it with that level of clarity, then we will submit. But Allah has given them this ability in order to guide the rest of humanity. This is the paradigm of divine leadership, which, by the way, the entire human race lacks. And by the way, if you really examine, it's impossible to have it until and unless Allah appoints it. So Allah says, وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عِلْمِ. He knows what is in front of them, what is behind them. Who is Allah talking about? His agents. مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَشْفَعُ. Who can represent, who can have shifa'a? مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَشْفَعُ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ. Who can represent Allah except by His permission? إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ. Allah knows what is in front of them and Allah knows what is behind them. And Allah says they cannot avail themselves of any knowledge. وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءَ. And they cannot avail themselves of that information except by the will of Allah. So proof positive that divine leadership is not only the condition where God, the Almighty, appoints, but the consistent condition within this appointment is that Allah also must endow them with knowledge that is beyond the normal. The kind of knowledge that will enable them to lead the world in the right direction. The kind of knowledge that will enable them to decipher wrong from right. The kind of knowledge that will bring growth and harmony for society. The kind of knowledge that will bring tranquility and closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The kind of the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is why you find Allah is describing Adam as the first agency of God and the angels who are endowed with tremendous amount of knowledge, tremendous amount of capabilities. They don't even consume the way we consume. They do not tire the way you and I tire. So we are limited in our physicalities, but yet we're higher than they are because of our spirituality. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam states that the human being who follows and gets close to Allah and obeys Him in a complete submission, the way Ibrahim alayhi salam was, the way the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was, the way the Ahlul Bayt and all the great prophets and all the prophets, the way they submitted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then they become greater than the angels. Greater. In Najul Balagh, Imam describes that. By the same token, that endowed human being who's been chosen and gifted with so many gifts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when that human being rejects Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that human being starts to create fitna and starts to create trouble in society and starts to, in other words, cause chaos and mayhem, facade, you find that human being is now lower than the animals. Kal an'am bal hum adal. Like cattle, Allah says no. Like worse than them. Because at least the animals do what they're supposed to do. Here it's very important for us to understand that our potential swings between these two extremities. But for us to reach those high stations, we have to have divinely appointed leaders. Leaders who have the pristine quality, not the ones who did stupid things and foolish things, and just because they were close to the Prophet, or just because they were known to be in the vicinity of the Prophet, that suddenly they inherit this appointment because people want to give it to them. No, that's not how it works. Allah selects that even prophets themselves cannot select. Even if, for example, Sulaiman wanted to find out who will inherit him, who will succeed him, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you see, who brings Asib bin Barkhiya forward to show that he will succeed Sulaiman. You find Musa alayhi salam, when he's going to Fir'aun, Harun was already a prophet of God. Even under that condition, Musa alayhi salam knows and realizes that he cannot appoint Harun with him. He says, وَجْعَلِّ وَزِيرًا مِنْ أَهْلِ هَارُونَ أَخِي. Appoint my brother as my helper. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَشْفَعُ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِي يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِنْ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءَ. And the authority of Allah, وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Follow this verse in Ayat al-Kursi 255, 256, and 257. You will see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing His authority. وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَلَا يَؤُودُهُ حِفْظُهُمَا. It does not lessen Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in its protection and in its management. This is the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah now is saying to the angels that we have no knowledge except that which you have taught us. Right? قَالُوا سُبْحَانَكَ لَا عِلْمَ لَنَا إِلَّا مَا عَلَّمْتَنَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَلِيمُ الْحَكِيمُ. Indeed, O Allah, You are the most knowledgeable. You are the one who has all knowledge. You are the most wise. Subhanallah. Proof positive. When it comes to leadership, one of the conditions is knowledge. Of course, knowledge in full practice. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turns to Adam metaphorically. And he says, قَالَ يَا آدَمْ أَنْبِئْهُمْ بِأَسْمَائِهِمْ. Now look how Allah is proving to the angels. O Adam, inform them of their names. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now has taught Adam secrets, and Allama talks about the secrets of the universe, how the system works, the way Imam Ali alayhi salam knew secrets because he was taught by the Prophet. They said, before the messenger departed this world, he whispered into my ears, and what he whispered opened 1,000 doors. And those 1,000 doors opened 1,000 doors. That was that transference of Ruhul Qudus. And you find that that was essential by which now to really manage. Though Imam Ali alayhi salam's knowledge was complete, but when he took that mantle of imamate, that distribution of responsibility required esoteric knowledge, exoteric knowledge. The kind of knowledge that requires him to make judgment, deep judgment, when there is breach of justice, when there is prognostication about the future. How do you answer that? What shall come tomorrow? How do you know what shall come tomorrow? And if you say something that the opposite comes tomorrow, then the credibility of this individual is marginalized. And Allah will never let his leaders, never let his representatives remain in that state of ignorance that they don't know. And subhanAllah, their wisdom is so deep that if they don't know something, then they don't say it. For Imam Ali alayhi salam says, the strength of a true believer is to be able to say, I don't know, when they don't know. But guaranteed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lets our prophets and imams know everything that is needed to know. And when something is asked of them that is not relevant to their leadership, and they say, I don't know, by the way, that is to know. For when somebody can say, I don't know, then that individual knows. For they know their boundaries. The most dangerous person is the one who doesn't know their boundaries. And reaching that level of knowledge seeps into one's heart and one's nature. That Imam Ali alayhi salam says, Al-ilmu ala thalathati ashbar. Idha wasala ila shabr al-awwal takabbar. وَإِذَا وَصَلَ إِلَى الشَّبْرِ الثَّانِي تَوَاضَ وَإِذَا وَصَلَ إِلَى الشَّبْرِ الثَّالِثِ عَلِمَ أَنَّهُ لَا يَعْلَمُ شَيْئًا. Look at the three stages of knowledge. Imam says the three stages. The first stage, when the person gains a little knowledge, they become proud. Many a people are like that. Oh, I know that. I've read that. Oh, yeah. I saw it. You know, I went to school. I have my degree. تَكَبَّر. Says when they reach the second stage, they become humble. Tawada. When they reach the second stage, they realize, oh, that showing off is actually the sound of an empty barrel making noise. So let me not show off. You know what? I've realized how little I know. But that second stage, you become humble. But that's not enough. For becoming humble and knowing that you know is still teetering on the edge of possible arrogance. وَإِذَا وَصَلَ إِلَى الشَّبْرِ الثَّالِثِ. The third stage. This is the stage you and I need to aim at. And prophets and imams are at that stage. عَلِمَ أَنَّهُ لَا يَعْلَمُ شَيْئًا. They realize, they know that they know nothing. Because they realize that wisdom is knowing how little you know. Ignorance is not knowing how little you know. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing this at the foundational level. When we talk about Imam Hussein in Karbala, when we talk about his speeches, when we talk about his sermons, even the sermon of Arafat, the dua of Imam Hussein that was recited, inshallah we'll touch on that. The speeches that he gave to the people of Kufa, the speeches that he gave at Karbala, the speeches that he gave in Medina, in Mecca, were filled with wisdom. The kind of wisdom that scholars until today try to dissect, and they're unable to understand the full breadth of their knowledge. Fatima alayhi salam, when she came to the court to claim her fadak, the khutbah that she gave, known as khutbah luma, you find that scholars until today are perplexed by its depth and beauty. Because Allah, when He chooses His agencies, He endows them with knowledge. He endows them with unique abilities to also act on that knowledge. For not only do they have the knowledge, but they are on the knowledge. They are the knowledge. What they say is the knowledge. We can actually write law based on what they said and what they did. Forget about even if they didn't say. We can actually encode the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just by their actions. How is that possible? Because Allah chooses them. So Allah says, قَالَ يَا آدَمُ أَنْبِئْهُمْ بِأَسْمَائِهِمْ فَلَمَّا أَنْبَأْهُمْ بِأَسْمَائِهِمْ قَالَ أَلَمْ أَقُلْ لَكُمْ إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ غَيْبَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَأَعْلَمُ مَا تُبْدُونَ وَمَا كُنْتُمْ تَكْتُمُونَ. Subhanallah. Listen to that. Adam, Allah says, inform them of the names. So Adam informs the angels. Things that the angels didn't even know about. And Allama goes deep into this and he says, of course, one of those highest names was the name of the Holy Prophet himself, was the name of Ahlul Bayt. That these are the agencies when Allah says, Alladhi khalaqa fasawwa, walladhi qaddara fahada, that He creates and makes it complete, gives it destiny and guides, that guide pre-exists all existences. That if the guide did not pre-exist, then the function of the existent is nullified because it has no direction after that. So the guide must pre-exist. That's why the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam stated that I was there even before Adam was there. Why? Because he is of that ultimate name. That Allah has given him this ability by which not only to be honored with knowledge, but even when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took him to the highest stations, Subhanalladhi asra bi 'abdihi laylan min al-masjid al-haram ila al-masjid al-aqsa alladhi barakna hawlahu linuriyahu min ayati. Allah says, Subhanalladhi asra bi 'abdihi. He raised his servant to the furthest mosque. That even Jibreel, who is one of the most revered angels to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, was unable to reach that station because of the endowment of divine leadership. And this is very crucial for you and I to understand. So that when we talk about Imam Hussein alayhi salam, we're not talking about an ordinary human being. We're talking about a chosen extraordinary human being who is so endowed with wisdom and knowledge that every move he made towards his destiny to sacrifice himself was profound. How he spoke to Hur, how he spoke to Umar ibn Sa'd, how he spoke to his companions, how he spoke to the enemies, how he spoke to the believers, how he spoke to Zuhair ibn Qayn, how he spoke to Habib ibn Madahir, how he spoke to his own sons, his own relatives. Each one was a lesson for us to take because that is the power of leadership. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevates them. So notice here, by the way, in this conversation, Allah now is looking at the angels, metaphorically. قَالَ أَلَمْ أَقُلْ لَكُمْ إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ غَيْبَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. The angels know that Allah knows the hidden secrets of the skies and the earth. But Allah is confirming, not by taunting them to tell them that I know, but to let them know that Adam is a special human being. He's Khalifatullah, and through his generation shall come the great leaders like Nuh alayhi salam, like Ibrahim alayhi salam, like Musa alayhi salam, like Isa alayhi salam, like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Who are these important people in the branches? For guiding humanity in the right direction. So when we talk about promoting good and forbidding evil, when you say ta'muruna bil ma'ruf wa tanhauna 'anil munkar, when we talk about these things, you know, that we have to promote good and that we have to forbid evil, the first question you and I must always ask, and I cannot stress enough on this issue, is the fact that how do I delineate what is right and what is wrong? How? Allah says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. Indeed, in the Messenger of Allah, Rasulullah, أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ is your best example, best role model. So if you and I have a question, how can I promote the best out there and demote the worst out there? If you and I don't hold on to Allah and His Messenger, You and I will never do it. That's why when I listen to motivational speakers, well-known motivational speakers, Anthony Robbins, Wayne Dyer, Deepak Chopra, they all speak really well. Even people like Brené Brown, who talks about vulnerabilities, people like Simon Sinek, Joe Dispenza, they're all good in what they do. They're excellent in what they do. But when you listen to the holistic message, it's impossible to bring about the level of clarity that brings inner harmony. When Allah says, أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَتْمَئِنَّ الْقُلُوبُ إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ The believers are those when they hear the name of Allah, their hearts palpitate because now they're in the rhythm of God. They're in the rhythm of guidance. They're in the rhythm of the prophets. They're in the rhythm of the Quran. They're in the rhythm of the imams. Very important to understand that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَجِلَ قُلُوبُهُمْ And when the Quran is recited to them, وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُ You find that their faith increases because they connect with the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we connect, we're ready to sacrifice because that connection is proof of love. As I mentioned yesterday and the day before, that love and sacrifice are inseparable. And we can say unequivocally that Imam Hussein alayhi salam unequivocally had the greatest love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his time. No one could surpass him because of the sacrifice that he gave. Like the Holy Prophet's sacrifice was second to none. Like Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib, you find his sacrifice was second to none. The sacrifice of Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib, was second to none. The sacrifice of Fatima al-Zahra, Salamullah, second to none. The sacrifice of Zainab, alayhi salam, second to none. And you find the sacrifice even of the child Ruqayya, who was 4 years old, of the daughter of Imam Hussein, alayhi salam, second to none. Because her mere existence was the representation and the fulfillment of the divine leadership of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking to the angels that, did I not tell you that I know what is in it? And that I know what you manifest and what you hide? It's very interesting. You find that the angels are being told. And what Allah is telling them to tell us. And they obeyed Allah. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about leadership in the Quran, when Allah says, for example, Allahu Nuru Samawati wal Ard, Allah is describing Nuru Samawati wal Ard, Mathalu Nuri Kamishkatin fi Misbah. I'll describe it in my subsequent lectures about how Allah gives us this parable, a magnificent parable of light in a niche with a lamp and one light upon the other, Nurun ala Nur. يَهْدِ اللَّهُ لِنُورِهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَضْرِبُ اللَّهُ الْأَمْثَالَ لِلنَّاسِ These are similitudes for mankind. Suffice it to say that. We go to Karbala, we go to Imam Hussein alayhi salam. That Imam now is leaving and he's arrived in Karbala. But while he's leaving Mecca, you find that he sends, in that period of time, he sends Muslim ibn Aqeel to go to Kufa to prepare the way for him to come. A little bit of history is very important for us to understand because all these conversations you and I are going to talk about is all built on the people of the time as the people of today as to how much they believed in this divine leadership. Because it all boils down to this, the acceptance of divine leadership. And if you and I have any doubts about such leaders, then you and I, our faith will always be in doubt. And God forbid, we join the army of people like Yazid. Not only is the doubt now bad, but that doubt has led us into the eternal abyss of losing dunya and akhirah, for now we will go and massacre the very institution that God is establishing. And that is the ultimate kufr. Ultimate kufr. And this conversation is about that. Imam Hussain alayhi salam sends Muslim ibn Aqeel to Kufa. Muslim, as you know, was the cousin of Imam Hussain alayhi salam. Aqeel, his father, was the brother of Imam Ali alayhi salam. And the children of Aqeel were the ones who gave the most sacrifices in Karbala among the numbers. when he came to the numbers between in the Banu Hashim family, it was the children of Aqeel who gave the most lives. Muslim was a very, very devout servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Hussein strategically chooses him because he was the type of person who would not sell himself for any price. رِجَالٌ لَا تُلْهِيهِمْ تِجَارَةٌ وَلَا بَيْعٌ عَنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. He is not an imam. He is not a prophet. But he is appointed by Imam Hussein alayhi salam. And look at his indomitable stance when he meets Ibn Ziyad. Quick history. So Muslim arrives. The people of Kufa, as you know, wrote letters to Imam Hussein alayhi salam. There were over 150 letters written to Imam Hussein alayhi salam. And these 150 were not ordinary people. These were the leaders of various clans. And they all wrote letters to Imam Hussein that Yazid now has proclaimed himself the Khalifa. Muawiyah is dead. It's time for us to rise and establish the justice that Allah decreed when Imam Ali alayhi salam was appointed as the successor to the Holy Prophet. So Imam takes these letters. When he leaves Medina, he carries them with him. When he arrives in Mecca, he keeps it in the baskets. As he's going towards Kufa, he's carrying them as proof and evidence. Now, some who wrote the letter, people like Suleiman bin Sard al-Khaza'i, was a very devout servant of Ahlul Bayt, and he actually asked the people of Kufa to rise and to write letters. So he was one of those incubators of positivity. Hani ibn Urwa was a very devout servant of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. And Muslim actually, when he comes to Kufa, he stays in the house of Hani ibn Urwa. And you find that Hani welcomes him. And Hani ibn Urwa was a reputable figure in Kufa. He had his own army, he had his own people, he was a very powerful man. But he was a devout servant of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. He was a devout Shia of Ali ibn Abi Talib, Hani ibn Urwa. You find that these personalities welcome Muslim. So at first it was all jubilance, thousands and tens of thousands of people of Kufa supporting Muslim ibn Aqeel. This lesson, by the way, is very important for us to understand that today many a times we show love and affection for our living Imam Sahib al-Zaman alayhi salatu wasalam. But how do we know that when the Imam comes and trials and tribulations will come upon us by us accepting him as our Imam, but let us say a tyrant group starts to threaten us and now our lives are put in danger, would we then abscond and give up our positions, or would we remain steadfast until we die? People like Hani ibn Urwa gave his life, and he was dragged and beaten by Ibn Ziyad with a stick till his nose was broken. These are the kind of people we need to revere and to look up to and see within our hearts how much we love such people. For they were affluent. They were very, very respected in the community. Why would they give up their comfort zones for something that may lead to their own destruction? They didn't care because they love Allah. قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. So Ibn Ziyad, as you know, is now appointed as governor of Kufa. Ibn Ziyad was already the governor of Basra. It's the first time in history where a governor is governing two cities. Because Ibn Ziyad was known to be such a vicious man, his father, Ziyad, was known as the butcher of Arabia. The man used to indiscriminately kill people left, right, and center. This is his illegitimate son, known as Ibn Marjana. Ibn Marjana because Marjana was his mother, the name of his mother. So he's not even given a name under his father. He was known as Ibn Marjan. That's how wicked he was. He enters Kufa with a few people, easily to be dismantled. And people thought that when he entered with pomp and glory with his small entourage, people thought this was Imam Hussein alayhi salam. So they welcomed him. And he paid attention to who was welcoming him. And why was he sent quickly? Because news was spreading that Imam Hussein was going towards Kufa. Kufa was known to be the seat of power for Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, the followers of Amir al-Mu'mineen. And Muawiyah and Yazid knew that these were the people who were strong enough who would resist their desire to now dominate the people under their pretended belief and their usurpation of power, which didn't belong to them. So they had to challenge. So he sends Ibn Ziyad. Ibn Ziyad rapidly threatens the people of Kufa to such a degree that there were skirmishes that took place between the soldiers of Ibn Ziyad. Ibn Ziyad was such a coward, he runs into the palace and locks the door. Now we know that Nu'man bin Bashir was the governor of Kufa at that time. And you find that he was a weakling, relatively. In other words, he wasn't that harsh. And Yazid removes him and puts Ibn Ziyad in power. And Ibn Ziyad starts his massacring. And he realizes that Muslim ibn Aqeel is in town and he needs to stop him. So what does he do? He starts threatening every family. And one of the threats that he put was to say that the army of Yazid from Damascus is coming and soon will kill all these people if they don't join his army. As a result, you find that many people abandon Muslim. Muslim ibn Aqeel had 30 people behind him in Salah. Even that, by the time he was finishing his Salah, as he's leading Salah, he looks behind, almost everybody is gone, except a few like Hani ibn Urwa. Hani is then called into the palace of Ibn Ziyad, and he's beaten until he is executed, and his body is dragged in the city of Kufa. So that's just to show, don't mess with me, I am the mafia. I will kill you and I will kill your family. So Muslim ibn Aqeel now is left alone. And that's the world we live in today, brothers and sisters. If you cut it down to the bottom line, the rule of thumb in life is, when you hold on to the way of Allah and you fight for justice, you end up becoming lonely. You end up becoming rejected by the majority of the people because you're no longer bowing to the status quo. And that's the problem with the world today. And it has always been a problem as such. And our advice from the Quran is that never, ever give up on your tawakkal on Allah. قُلْ هُوَ الرَّحْمَنُ آمَنَّ بِهِ وَعَلَيْهِ تَوَكَّلْنَا فَسَتَعْلَمُونَ مَنْ هُوَ فِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. You will know who is wrong, but hold on to the rope of Allah. So Muslim now is wandering the city. He doesn't know what to do. He's completely has no place to go. And he has come to prepare for the Imam to come to Kufa. How must he feel? Terrible. He finally sits in front of a house, and there was a woman, a pious woman, whose name was Tawa. And she notices this young man sitting at her doorstep. And she tells him, go. Why are you at my house? He says, I have no place to go. This is how the tide changes. We claim we love Ahlul Bayt, but a little threat and we abandon. But this is the lesson for us to take. How far can we go? Tawa says to him, what do you need? She says, I'm thirsty. Can you give me something to drink? She feeds him. She gives him food. Then he says, I have no place to go. Now, Tawa's son was a vicious man. And he was a servant of, he was working for Ibn Ziyad. So he comes home, and Muslim, as you know, is hiding, taking refuge in his house, his mother's house. And Tawa's son immediately goes to Ibn Ziyad and reveals the hiding place of Muslim. History shows that soon thereafter, the army comes and now starts to challenge Muslim ibn Aqeel. And you find that that challenge leads him to fight and to fight and to fight until he's cornered in an alleyway. And when he's cornered in an alleyway, even then, they said it was from morning to afternoon to evening. And they couldn't subdue Muslim. One man, to show you the fight that this man had, trying to maintain authority of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that was given to him by Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Tragically, they dug a moat and they kept pushing him with rocks, and Muslim falls into this moat and he's subdued and his sword is sheathed and now he's taken to Ibn Ziyad. And the tragedy begins that as Ibn Ziyad is now interrogating Muslim, and Muslim is indomitable, nothing changes his mind, that even while he is going to the palace, he begins to cry. And a soldier says to him, are you crying for what reason? He said, not for any other reason but the fact that my master Hussein ibn Ali is on his way to this abandoned community. A community that has abandoned us. That was he was crying for. And then when he's interrogated by Ibn Ziyad, just like Qais, who was the agent of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, who precedes Muslim, who comes with the news to the people, he's arrested. And Ibn Ziyad calls him a spy. And he's silent. And he said, if you are truly not a spy of Hussein ibn Ali, then get on the pulpit and tell the people how wrong Hussein ibn Ali is. So Qais gets on the pulpit and he begins to tell the people how right Imam Hussein is and how wrong Ibn Ziyad is. And soon then after, he is pulled from that pulpit, dragged, beaten, and thrown off the high building till he becomes a martyr. Muslim ibn Aqeel, the same thing. And in his last will and wish, he says, I want you to inform my cousin Hussein, my master. He doesn't call him cousin. He said, my master, send him the message that he should not come to Kufa, for indeed the people have turned themselves upon him, against him. And Muslim ibn Aqeel, as he begins to drink the water, because his lip was so cut and bleeding that he couldn't even drink the water. Almost like a foreshadowing that his love for Imam Hussein was so great that how could he take that sip of water when his master will be denied that for 3 days in Karbala, to the extent that he will become shaheed with a parched tongue. How? So he doesn't drink. And then he is thrown off the high palace and beheaded. And his head is put at the gates. Imam Hussein alayhi salam is on his way to Kufa. He gets the message that Muslim ibn Aqeel has been martyred. He says, Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. That our destiny is in a different direction. And the Imam cries. But what is very tragic also is that Muslim had taken his two sons, Muhammad and Ibrahim. They were little kids. And even they were not left alone by Ibn Ziyad. That even they were killed and beheaded. That Ibn Ziyad puts a bounty on their heads. And while they're hiding, for after Muslim was caught, and after the event of Karbala, he wouldn't even leave these children alone. This Muslim had his daughter also with Imam Hussein alayhi salam. He had other sons with him, with Imam Hussein alayhi salam. These were the two young ones. Even they were not left alone. They say Muhammad and Ibrahim, they were very similar in age. One was older, Muhammad was older than Ibrahim. That they used to talk to each other and caress each other and have love for each other. That they were both taken after they were found to the edge of the riverbank and executed by a man who was so vicious, heartless, following Ibn Ziyad. He was so enamored by Ibn Ziyad's authority that he wanted to convince him how evil he is. That even Ibn Ziyad, as evil as he was, couldn't bear the fact that after he brings the heads of these two young boys, he beheads them, throws their body into the Euphrates. He puts it in a bag and brings it to Ibn Ziyad. For these young boys were begging this man, that what will you answer Allah when we are the children of grandchildren of the Holy Prophet? He says, I don't care. This is when you let go of the leadership of Allah. You go towards Iblis, that you start to murder people, behead them. But look how foolish this man was. That he lost dunya and akhirah. To the extent that when he brings the heads, Ibn Ziyad sees his little heads and he says, why did you not bring them to me alive? He says, well, I wanted to bring their heads because that's what I wanted to please you, how I killed them. He said, you have no shame to even to have some compassion for them? He said, no. He said, if you would have brought them alive, I would have rewarded you even higher. Look at the foolishness of a man to try to convince Iblis, like a person who joins a gang, and in order to please the leader of the gang, you commit greater murders and greater crimes and greater evils so that you're respected even more. This is the way of Iblis. Ibn Ziyad responds that he is so ashamed of what that happened, for this man had no shame, but here was a tactical game, for he didn't want to give him any money. That was the reason why Ibn Ziyad did that. to show that you cannot outdo my trickery. If you think you can trick people into killing, you cannot fool me. And he has the man executed immediately. And his head was rolling in the same place where he beheaded these two young boys. So the moral of the story, الحاكم التكاثر حتى زرتم المقابر كلا سوف تعلمون ثم كلا سوف تعلمون كلا لو تعلمون علم اليقين لترون الجحيم ثم لترونها عين اليقين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises it that abundance has diverted you till you come to the grave. You will see with certainty hell. عَلَى لَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ لَلْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ وَسَيَعْلَمُ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا أَيَّ مُنْقَلَبٍ يَنْقَلِبُونَ.